Hey there, everybody. Welcome to Casa de Kane. This is our house. And it's been a while since we got to hang out together. I missed y'all. If you're not familiar with this, this is our online devotional series we call Grandfather's Box. This is something, a devotional series that we began during this time of pandemic. We've done 99 episodes together, if you can believe it. This is our 100th episode. We took a little break from it for a while, just because if I am going to talk about what it means to take Sabbath rest, to care for oneself spiritually, physically, and especially during this time when so many things start kicking up again in the world, I needed to take some time to care for our church family, for my own family, and for my own spiritual and physical well-being. So we paused our devotional series at 99, but I had to keep going. I want to see the numbers change. So this is our 100th episode. And as I've shared in the past, I love doing this. I love hanging out with you guys. I love finding something fun and creative and connecting it with the truth and love of Jesus Christ. So though I don't have the box with me right now, I am still going to make you guess on what we're going to talk about, on the object that we're going to be talking about. This is an object that is red, it is round, and it goes by many names, including grape, cherry, and beefsteak. Do you know what it could be? Something that is red, it is round, and it goes by many names, including cherry, grape, and beefsteak. If you're not sure what it is, it's actually the plant right behind me there. It's a tomato, right? Cherry tomatoes, grape tomatoes, beefsteak tomatoes. This little garden here is something that my family and I started at the beginning of this pandemic. We have some green peppers over here that I'm not going to show you because they're embarrassing looking. But we have a pineapple tree that's actually doing quite well. We've already harvested lettuce. We had some celery earlier. This was something that my family and I started doing right at the beginning to supplement our daughter's education for their agriculture class. Just something fun to do and hoping that they would try fresh things that they grew. But of course, little girls, they didn't want to try a lot of them. But I was actually thinking about this tomato plant. This guy who was yay big when he bought them, he's probably about 5.5, almost 6 feet now. He's produced maybe like 5 or 7 tiny grape-sized tomatoes. Just decides to grow big and that's it. That's fine. But during the summer, I came out here one time. And I realized that in the heat, nobody watered him for probably 3-4 days. And he was looking kind of sad. He was looking pretty thirsty. But the thing that really struck me was the watering can. Was less than a foot from him. I mean, the very thing he needed was right there next to him. And yet he couldn't take it. He wasn't getting it. It was right there, less than a foot, foot and a half away. And I've been thinking during this time of pandemic when it's so easy to isolate. It's so easy to stop spiritual disciplines like being connected to a church family, being connected to fellow Christians. You know, sometimes the water's sitting right there and we're just not reaching out for it. Reminds me of something I was actually reading earlier in Matthew chapter 13. If you're not familiar with Matthew chapter 13, it's known as the Kingdom of Heaven chapter. Jesus has all these parables just going on and on about what the kingdom of heaven, the kingdom of God is like. That this thing that goes beyond human comprehension and understanding. So he tries to compare it to stuff that we might be able to grasp and understand better. And so here Jesus is talking to farmers about what the kingdom of God is. And he says in Matthew 13, halfway through verse 3, he says, "Listen, a farmer went out to plant some seeds. As he scattered them across his field, some seeds fell on the footpath, and the birds came and ate them. Other seeds fell on shallow soil with underlying rocks. The seeds sprouted quickly because the soil was shallow, but the plants soon withered under the hot sun. And since they didn't have deep roots, they died. Other seeds fell among thorns that grew up and choked out the tender plants. Still other seeds fell on fertile soil, and they produced a crop that was 30, 60, and even 100 times as much as had been planted. Anyone with ears to hear should listen and understand." So, what is a seed? Sorry about that. UPS guy stopped by. Anyways, what is a seed? It is life. It is potential. It's sustenance. It's hope for the future. It's the thing that makes us believe something good can grow, right? And so Jesus is comparing the kingdom of heaven, the kingdom of God, to a seed. He says that, you know, a farmer goes out to scatter seeds, to scatter that which brings life, has potential, hope for the future. And some seeds that they fall on the foot beaten path. Something that's been packed down so tight that nothing can get in. And you've probably, just like me, gone out to water plants that have been a little too dry. And the dirt is just, it's so hard that at first it almost seems to not want to accept the water. You know, it just sits right on top. Or it'll just fall down the edges of the dirt and kind of collect near the bottom. And if we're not careful, we can become so spiritually dried out, so packed down because of things, emotional, spiritual, that we don't let the life-giving water in to feed the seed. Jesus says other times that the seed falls on shallow soil. And with shallow soil, the dirt has all the nutrients at the top because it's shallow. The nutrients can't go anywhere else. But even though it sprouts up quickly when the hard stuff happens, when the difficult things, the heat of the day comes and scorches it, it doesn't have deep roots. Sometimes if we're not careful for our faith, we can become fly-by-night Christians. We can become church hoppers looking for the perfect church, which doesn't exist. Going from church to church to church, or looking for the perfect pastor, or we think we finally found him, and then there's one small thing that happens, and we feel like we need to move on. And sometimes we do. But are we setting illogical expectations? Are we starting off by trying, and then within a month or a week or 2 weeks, just giving up because there's just too much to do? Jesus says other times that the seed, it's like it's planted and it starts to grow, something good starts to grow out of it, but the weeds of life kind of wrap around it and choke it out. There's that busyness. I have too much to do. You know, I've often said that if we don't make time for God, we don't find time for God. It's like our money. If we don't tell our money where to go, we find we don't know where it went, right? If we don't purposely say that 1 hour on Sunday, that is for God, that is my sacred time with God, that devotional time, I carve it out. Nothing else is allowed to go there. Satan will fill it up for us. He'll quickly fill it up. It's just easy. It's easy to fall into those places. Look, this is not a condemnation thing. I'm sharing real life stuff that I've been through, that we've all kind of been through together. You know, it's easy to to get lost in the anger of the day, the fear of the day, and become that foot-beaten path. It's easy to think, oh, I got hope, and then let it die, not let it grow deep roots. And then when something happens, we just let it go. Even if we're like, oh, I'd rather not. Oh, I wish I had more time to. It's easy to let the junk of life choke out the true life giver that's in us. It's been said, if Satan can't make you sin, he's going to make you busy. If he can't make you busy, he's going to make you depressed. If he can't make you depressed, he's going to make you anxious. But Jesus wants to set you free of all of that. Now, wherever you're at, perhaps for you, it's not safe yet to come back from the pandemic. That's okay. Hear me clearly. I'm not saying go back right this minute if you don't feel safe doing so. But some of us are honestly going over to our friends and our family's houses without masks on. Some of us are going out to the grocery store and going hanging out. And then we're using the excuse of COVID to not do less by going to church. This is something only you can answer within your own soul. Is it valid or not? For some of us, we've just gotten out of the habit. If we're honest with ourselves, it wasn't purposeful. It's just things happened, craziness kind of caught up with us. Look, that's okay. I get that. This is your reminder. This is your call back to recenter. Whether it's with Salem here in Havana or not. Whether it's with United Methodism or another Christian denomination. Look, we all worship the same Jesus. We don't got different ones, okay? The question is, not just is your seed growing, but what kind of dirt are you putting on it? You know, are you letting the seed in? Are you taking time to turn up that dirt? Sometimes the water, it's sitting right here. And in Florida, one thing I learned is when you're thirsty in Florida, you've actually already been dehydrated. I didn't know that. Especially when I lived in Central Florida, I heard this over and over again. You need to be purposeful about hydration in Florida, because you can get so used to not being hydrated that you don't even recognize that you're drying out. I think we can do the same thing spiritually, y'all. And so the question ultimately becomes, not just are you letting the seed in, but what kind of dirt is it going into? And as we worship a God that ever changes us, ever grows us, a God of resurrections, a God of new life, a God of life in abundance, as one tiny plant not only grows into a large plant, but it produces many more seeds, life in abundance. The question becomes, what are we doing to cultivate our soil? There goes the UPS guy again. Let's pray for him, okay? And let's pray for our own spiritual health as well, because I'm in the same boat y'all are. Heavenly Father God, I want to take a minute to lift my brothers and sisters up to you right now. I know that if I don't purposefully choose to spend time with you, I find that I get dried out too easily and don't even recognize it sometimes. I thank you for that purposeful discipleship. I thank you for that purposeful devotional time that keeps me going, that keeps me strong, God. I pray over my brothers and sisters that perhaps right now that they're realizing they didn't know they were as dehydrated as they really were. And that's not a shame thing. That's a come back home, we love you thing. Lord God, I pray for your strength over them. I pray that you would give them courage to reach out for the water. It's right there next to them being offered. I pray, Lord, that you give them courage to keep coming back to the life-giving, living waters over and over and over and over again. I pray, Lord, that during this time of pandemic, it would not be a time that divides us and dwindles the church, but binds us and grows us in faith. I thank you for this opportunity to sit with my friends, to just talk once again, to be back at this. And we pray, Lord, that you be with every soul, every home, every family, every relationship, as we'll be very careful to give you and only you all the glory, honor, and praise, now and forever. Amen. One final note. If you don't already have a church family, no matter where you live on this globe, contact me. I'll be happy to help you look. I'll be happy to find out what kind of worship you're into, try to help you start to vet churches in your local area, find some stuff that's conducive for you, but we got to be proactive about this. We got to work at this. You're worth it. And your spiritual peace and growth is worth it too. I love you. Stay safe. God's peace. And I'll see you next Wednesday.